Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us at Pacific Neuroscience Institute and Little Company of Mary's Regional Neuroscience Grand Rounds. We've had an exciting stream of speakers and topics over the last several months, and it's correlated with the regional initiative of Providence to organize and allow a lot of our educational offerings to be available through all of the different ministries in our region. And with that, the interest, the questions, and the breadth of neuroscience topics have expanded beautifully. So we really appreciate everybody's involvement with our conference. I'm very, very excited about our talk today. This is going to be our first talk on the topic of radiosurgery. And I think we have an excellent provider to go ahead and give us this introduction to stereotactic radiosurgery as it pertains to the neurosciences. Dr. Ji Kim is an assistant clinical professor of radiation oncology at the City of Hope. And she joined us, I believe, a little less than a year ago, taking over for Dr. Karen Sokolov, who is down here in the South Bay for several years and a wonderful colleague of ours, along with Dr. Garth Green. I've very much enjoyed working with her. She's an assistant clinical professor. She received her undergraduate degree in biochemistry from the University of California, Davis in Northern California. And then she went on to do her master's in medical science and get her MD degree from Drexel University in Philadelphia. She did her internal medicine internship year at the University of Nevada, and then completed her residency in radiation oncology at the City of Hope National Medical Center over in Duarte. Her practice is primarily based out here in the South Bay, at the Advanced Care Center here in Torrance, and was working over in Antelope Valley for 9 years prior to coming here. We've really enjoyed working with you, Dr. Kim, and we're very much looking forward to your talk. So thank you very much for joining us today.
Well, thank you for having me today. And thank you, Dr. Sivakumar, for that wonderful introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you to all for being in attendance to today's talk. Today's talk will be on stereotactic radiosurgery. So I have no disclosures. Today's learning objectives are listed here. So while I was on a family road trip, we had stopped to get some ice cream. And in front of this ice cream store was a telephone booth. Well, it was obvious to myself and to all the adults that were there that this was clearly a telephone booth. To my kids and to my cousin's kids, this was just a jungle gym play structure. Just like the telephone, stereotactic radiosurgery is not a new concept. It's been around for many years. However, the device or the machines that it has seen many innovative changes over the many years. So what is stereotactic radiosurgery? A pioneer in this field, or the neurosurgeon that coined this term, stereotactic radiosurgery, Dr. Lars Lexell in 1951 had described it as a single high dose of radiation stereotactically directed to an intracranial region of interest, maybe from X-ray, gamma ray, protons, or heavy particles. The present day, it has somewhat evolved to it being more defined as a high dose of ablative radiation delivered to a target localized in three dimensions with overall end-to-end precision on the order of 1 to 2 millimeters delivered over up to five treatments. So a quick comparison of SRS or stereotactic radiosurgery versus your more typical radiation treatment, like for breast, prostate, or stage 3 lung, or head and neck, your typical radiation treatments for those are going to be on the order about 2 gray per fraction, or treatment, and the treatments are going to be delivered daily, Monday to Friday, for a span of 5 to 6 weeks, to a total of around 50 to 60 gray. Whereas your SRS will be delivering these high doses of 20 to 30 gray in 1 to 5 treatments. And certainly that would require much higher precision and accuracy. So pass. A little bit of a history of the stereotactic technique itself is that the stereotaxis is a method of locating points in the brain using an external 3D frame. This concept originated with Robert Clark in 1895. Him, along with Victor Horsey in 1908, first built a device which was then used to study monkey brain. Neurologist Spiegel and neurosurgeon Weiss actually applied this technology to the human brain in 1947. They had used x-rays and plain films at that time to correlate the stereotaxis with intracranial landmarks. On the left, we have the timeline history of Gamma Knife, and on the right is the timeline history of the LINAC. So again, the pioneer Lars Lexell of SRS and Gamma Knife itself. He is a neurosurgeon in Sweden who first designed the stereotactic frame in 1949 and published and coined the term stereotactic radiosurgery in 1951. The first patient was treated with SRS using his frame. And at that time, the orthovoltage radiation was used, and that was in 1953. The treatments at that time were done on patients with trigeminal neuralgia and psychiatric disorders. The first Gamma Knife was used in 1968 with the cobalt-60 as the energy source. During the early years of the SRS, the LINAC was not quite accurate enough to be used for the SRS. So the first LINAC-based SRS was not until 1980s. The CyberKnife was then used in 1991. So here is pictured on the left is Lars Lexell in the early years of SRS where they had used his frame and the orthovoltage radiation. And then the later years, once he came up with the Gamma Knife itself, is the SRS treatment with the first versions of Gamma Knife. So present. There are three main types of machines that are used today for SRS. The oldest that is still used for SRS today is the Gamma Knife itself. Gamma Knife is named such because the energy source is cobalt-60, which decays to nickel. Two gamma rays with energies of 1.17 and 1.33 MV is emitted in the process. Its half-life is about 5.27 years. And there are several models that are still commonly used throughout the world. The older ones being the U and B model, and then the newer model is the C model, and the newest model is the perfection model, which is pictured on the left here. All of the Gamma Knives consist of cobalt-60 as the energy source. They align to the collimation system. The collimation system itself focuses the individual beams of the gamma radiation to a very precise focal point. In the UBC, the older models, the beam collimation is split between an internal collimation and a movable external helmet-based collimation system. Each external collimator helmet has an array of removable collimators with circular apertures that are used at different diameter fields to focus the points. And the Model C was an upgrade because it had a motorized APS. APS is a robot that moves the patient's head from one position or one isocenter position to the next without having the treating personnel to come into the room. Whereas the Model B and the older models required manual setup between each isocenter. In the new Gamma Knife, the Perfection on the left, the external helmet collimator is replaced entirely by a single internal collimation system. The Gamma Knife Perfection by Elekta has also new shieldings that are up to 100 times better than the older gamma knife. And it's a fully automated process that makes things easier for the treating physician or the treating team, as well as the patients. So gamma knife uses imaging studies that are acquired after the placement of the frame. So the patient would come in on the day of the treatment, get the frame placed, and then they would do the imaging with the CT and the MRI. And while the patient waits, the plan is made, and then the treatment is delivered, and then the frame is removed. Gamma knife does use, for localization, a Cartesian coordinate system, and that's just the XYZ coordinates. Another machine that is often used for SRS is the CyberKnife. CyberKnife is a LINAC on a robotic arm. This was created for SRS as an alternative to the gamma knife, but without having the need of a frame and without the need of the use of a cobalt 60 as the energy source. CyberKnife was invented at Stanford and first debuted in 1994. It was cleared to treat intracranial tumors in 1999, and then for tumors anywhere else in the body in 2001. This on the right is the new CyberKnife. So the original or the older CyberKnife models were a comb-based collimation, whereas the newest one is an MLC-based collimation, and it's also much faster than the previous versions. So the third machine or type of machines that is often used is the LINAC. The LINAC's original use did not include SRS. It was used for your more typical radiation treatments with standard fractionation, where patients get their lower dose daily for several weeks. And so much lower than the SRS, and the targets are often much larger. As the LINAC has become more accurate and more efficient, especially with VMAT or volumetric modulated arc therapy techniques that deliver radiation dose continuously as the treatment machine rotates, along with the IGRT or image guided radiation therapy capability with cone beam CTs, the LINAC has become the more common mode of SRS treatments. And that's just because LINACs are more versatile in that one machine can treat patients for SRS as well as your standard fractionation treatments. Whereas the gamma knife, you're going to be more limited to the intracranial SRS. And because it's based on a frame, it's a single fraction. Whereas the, and also the CyberKnife is also somewhat limited in that it's mainly for SRS and SBRT. But it is frameless, just like the LINAC. And so you can fractionate or treat as a single fraction. So on this slide, on the left is the true beam. And then on the right is the tomotherapy. Although both can be used for SRS with high precision, the tomotherapy does limit treatments to using just coplanar beams. Whereas the true beam, you're able to use non-coplanar beams as well. So just looking at the three together or reviewing the three different machines that are used for SRS, the gamma knife, you are able to treat smaller lesions at higher precisions. There's less dose to the surrounding normal brain. It is limited to intracranial lesions only. It uses a cone collimation, so it's best suited for circular targets. The treatment times are, however, long. Or can be very long. And then it is a frame base, so only single fractions can be delivered. CyberKnife has characteristics of, it's almost like a hybrid. It shares some with gamma knife as well as the LINAC. It can treat smaller lesion at higher precision. It's used for cranial, but also for extracranial sites. The original design was with cone collimation, but the newest CyberKnife does have MLC collimation. It does tend to have longer treatment time. It is frameless though, so you can fractionate or treat as a single treatment. The LINAC it can treat, it is the most versatile in that it treats, you're able to do the SRS type of treatment as well as the non-SRS type of radiation treatments. It treats cranial as well as extracranial sites. It uses MLC, so the targeting, the target shapes can be all sorts. The accuracy is at few millimeters now. It is frameless, so you can either fractionate or treat as a single treatment. And it has the quickest or quicker treatment times. All three of these modalities or machines do use CT and MRI for the treatment planning for SRS. The Gamma Knife, planning CT and MRI are done on the same day because the frame has to be placed first. But for the CyberKnife and the Linac, the CT and MRI can be done several days ahead of the treatment so that the planning can be done over those several days before the patient comes in for the actual treatment itself. So you can think of these machines as almost like similar to race cars. So on the picture here, this is the most recent F1 cars. This is a Ferrari, this is a Mercedes, and this is your Aston Martin. They're all very good and they will do a good job, but you know, they have its small nuances between the various machines. But to have a good SRS program, it does take more than just having the newest and best machine. Just as in the race cars, a good pit crew is just as important as the cars itself. I think that the radiation oncology team needs to be experienced so that they're comfortable in treating with the SRS and capable of executing the plan, as it's very different from your more typical or conventional radiation treatments, where in the more typical radiation treatments, the doses per treatment are a lot lower and they're delivered over daily, Monday through Friday, over typically 5 or 6 weeks. And if something is slightly off on one treatment, that would only be a fraction of the total dose of the treatment. But with SRS, you're giving, 1 to 5 treatments with a very high dose per treatment. And so accuracy and everyone on the team being on the same page is very, very important. Current clinical uses of SRS include vascular malformations, benign brain tumors, functional disorders, and malignant brain tumors for primary but mainly metastasis. So the original intent of SRS, like we reviewed in the history, was not used for brain metastasis. It was really for trigeminal neuralgia and neurologic disorders. But although we still treat some of those diseases with the SRS, the most common use of SRS now has become brain metastasis. And that's about 10 to 30% of all cancer patients can develop brain metastasis, and up to 50% of all metastatic cancers have brain metastasis during its course. So factors used to assess therapy for brain metastasis include location, size of lesion, number of metastases, whether they have symptoms or neurologic deficits, their age, performance status, primary tumor, extracranial disease, and of course, patient's input. The treatments currently available for treating brain metastasis include corticosteroids, surgical resection, whole brain radiation therapy, SRS, chemotherapy or immunotherapies, and hospice or supportive care. Oh, sorry, this is all. Let me move my screen back down. I think that was blocking some of the slides. Traditionally for brain metastasis, whether it was a single or multiple, was to get whole brain radiation. RTOG 9508 looked at whole brain versus whole brain plus SRS. It found that there was a median survival benefit when SRS was added to the treatment arm. They also saw that in the SRS arm, there was a statistically significant stabilization or improvement in KPS when the whole brain radiation, when compared to the whole brain radiation arm. Secondary analysis of the study with a graded prognostic assessment showed significant survival benefit in those with high GPA, regardless of 1 or 2 to 3 brain metastases. Neurocognitive decline following the whole brain radiation treatment has been well documented. So these subsequent studies below here looked at, can we treat SRS alone for those with 1 to 4 brain metastases and omit the whole brain radiation? These studies randomized patients with 1 to 4 brain mets to SRS plus or minus or whole brain. They found that there was no difference in overall survival. And at least in one study, the MD Anderson study showed lower overall survival with the addition of whole brain. All showed inferior neurocognitive or quality of life measurement when whole brain was added. So this established the use of SRS alone in those with 1 to 4 brain metastases. So prognostic index for patients with brain metastasis that is often used or is used is the graded prognostic assessment or GPA, which was updated in 2012 first to separate out for the different primary malignancies for those with brain metastasis. This was again updated more recently in 2020, which separated the lung non-small cell lung cancer to adenocarcinoma versus non-adeno, as well as to include for or account for the molecular biomarkers for lung cancer as well as melanoma. And just like the GPA students have in school, the GPA of 4.0 is the best and GPA 0 is the worst. Those with an expected survival of 3 months or who are asymptomatic but have brain met, it is recommended that they should just get supportive care. GPA is often used to guide treatments for brain metastasis as well as stratification for clinical trials. So there is a definite shifting in paradigm and treatment of brain metastasis where traditionally this had been all treated with whole brain radiation treatment. But because of the neurocognitive decline with whole brain radiation and the growing evidence of SRS being an effective treatment, even for those with multiple brain metastases, there is a shift in or emerging paradigm where SRS is often used and reused to see if we can save the whole brain until we need to use the whole brain radiation treatments. Current radiation dose for brain metastasis using SRS in a single fraction is based on the RTOG 9005, where different maximal doses were recommended based on size of the brain metastasis itself. In the post-operative setting, SRS dose is based on the N107C study, which set the dose based on the cavity volume itself. If the normal brain dose constraints cannot be met, or if the target is near a critical structure, it is recommended that the treatments are fractionated. And so when treatments are fractionated, just means to divide out the total dose and deliver the treatment in several treatments. Oftentimes it's 3 fractions or 3 treatments or 5 treatments. Common fractionated dose for SRS is 24 to 30 gray in 3 fraction or 25 to 35 gray in 5 fractions, but there are others. Timing of postoperative SRS is recommended to be done in 2 to 4 weeks, and that's because after a surgery, they have seen cavity shrinkage. And if this occurs most of the time, it's within the 3 weeks, but it is not recommended to go beyond the 4 weeks is because of local control can be diminished at that point. And the planning MRI is recommended that the, or required that it should be less than 7 days before the treatment. So when comparing these doses between the different fractionation, to do a true comparison, you really need to look at the biological equivalent dose, or the BED. BED is the measure of the true biologic dose delivered by a particular combination of dose per fraction and total dose to particular tissue characterized by specific alpha beta ratio. So different tissue will have different defined alpha beta ratio, and the tumor or brain metastasis will have an alpha beta of 12, whereas the normal brain tissue that is nearby has an alpha beta of 2. The first three row on this chart is of common doses given during SRS for brain metastasis. The first one is 20 and one fraction or one treatment, or 27 and 3, 25 in 5. And you can see that the BED for the tumor is slightly decreased as you go down or fractionate the dose. However, the BED for the brain or normal tissue is gonna be a lot more in a bigger increment of decrease when you do fractionate. As a sort of more equal comparison between the doses, just to illustrate that, the last three rows are just of the same total dose, but of different fraction schemes or fractionation. And you see that they're not the same, they do not equate to the same BED for both tumor or the brain. So radiation treatments is the principal goal for radiation treatments is always gonna be to optimize the therapeutic window, where you have a high tumor control and the normal tissue damage is low. The main concern or the main risk with SRS is brain radionecrosis. So the exact mechanism of this is yet not fully understood, but the radiation causes DNA damage and apoptosis of the tumor cells, but the nearby normal brain tissue is affected as well. And so the oligodendrocytes can undergo demyelinization. The astrocytes themselves can get vascular damage via VEGF, with both leading to inflammation and BBB disruptions, all leading to radiation necrosis. In order to minimize the risk of brain radionecrosis, certain dose constraints are currently used in SRS treatment planning. And I have listed them here, and they are based on several studies that have shown a significant increase in risk of this radionecrosis when the doses went beyond this. When it says B10 or B12, all that means is the volume of normal brain that would get 10 gray or 12 gray. And you do want to keep that under a certain volume. In this case, for single fraction, you want to keep B12 less than 10 cc and B10 less than 12 cc. Detection of brain radionecrosis is also often very difficult and problematic still. As on MRI, they appear very similar. So you can see here on just MRI alone, it's very difficult to tell whether this is brain radionecrosis or disease progression or recurrence. One study showed that when combining the functional brain imaging can also be often very helpful. And on one study, they showed that when combining image modalities, you can increase the sensitivity and specificity of diagnosing the radionecrosis. There is current ongoing study in France that is looking at comparing the FET PET with MR SPECT to see whether one is superior over the other in detecting radionecrosis. So treatment, if patients is asymptomatic, it is recommended to do observation alone, and they would be just followed with MRIs. If they are symptomatic, the treatments include either steroids, surgery, or bevacizumab. With surgery, they do see a rapid relief from any mass effect or brain edema. And at the same time, they're able to get pathology, which is gold standard for confirming whether this is truly radionecrosis versus a local recurrence. Bevacizumab is an anti-VEGF monoclonal antibody, and the current published data is not as clear as to whether it's truly can treat for brain necrosis. So currently there is an ongoing study at MD Anderson. It's a phase two study that is comparing the bevacizumab versus steroids for improvement in radionecrosis symptoms. And so we await that study as well. When evaluating an SRS plant, there are several criteria that we look for or we use to evaluate whether it's a good plant or not. Some of them include the conformity index, which is the ratio of tumor volume to the volume covered with a certain dose. Gradient index, which is the ratio of brain volume receiving 50% of the planned peripheral dose to the target volume. Gradient measure, which is the distance from 100% isodose line to the 50% isodose line. And the goal or the aim for these criteria is to have a higher CI and a lower GI or GM. But whether these criteria of having those high CI and lower GI and GM equates to a clinical significance is still yet to be seen. But we still use these criteria to evaluate the plant. But more importantly than the other criteria is the normal brain dose constraints. And single fraction, the goal is to have V12 less than 10 cc and V10 less than 12 cc. Current national guideline that's been recently published for treatment of brain metastasis. To review, in those who have asymptomatic brain metastasis, but they have also poor performance status or their systemic therapy options, they do not have any systemic therapy options, it is recommended that they should not be offered radiation treatment. However, SRS alone should be offered to patients who have 1 to 4 unresected brain metastases. This does exclude small cell carcinoma. And then SRS alone should be offered to patients who have 1 to 2 resected brain metastases if safely can be treated. And then for those who have 4 or more brain metastases or 2 or more resected brain metastases with better performance status can be offered either SRS, whole brain radiation, or a combination of the SRS plus whole brain. So access to care also remains to be a big issue in radiation oncology. Recent comparison from looking at back at 2005 versus 2020 showed that only a small percent of improved access was seen between those years. And nearly 2% of the entire US population remains to have poor geographic access to radiation treatment facility. And this is only looking at all types of radiation care. So if you were to narrow it down to access to SRS capable facility, this geographic access would be way worse. The univariate analysis for access showed that if you are more likely to be more than 50 miles from a facility, if you are living in a non-metro location, older patients, uninsured, lower median household income. But on a multivariate analysis showed that only non-metro seemed to be a significant factor. And then on the right here, on a separate study looking at RT or radiation access and race showed that the most underserved with poorest access was the Native Americans. future. So prior level one study had established SRS for 1 to 4 brain metastases. But for those who have more than 4 brain metastases, treatments have not been established yet. So retrospective studies do show that SRS would be a good or could be a good option, even those with more than 4 brain metastases, to potentially reduce the risk of their having neurological decline with whole brain. And then more recently, there has been a randomized study that showed lower neurocognitive decline when patients who were getting whole brain were started on memantine, as well as a separate randomized study that showed reduced risk of neurocognitive decline with hippocampal sparing whole brain radiation. So currently there is a ongoing trial, CCTG-CE7, that's looking at those with more than 4 brain metastases, or specifically 5 to 15 brain metastases, and randomizing to SRS versus hippocampal sparing whole brain along with memantine, and their primary endpoint of overall survival and neurocognitive progression-free survival. So although Gamma Knife and CyberKnife was first created specifically for SRS, the LINAC was not, but has evolved to be used for SRS. There are now more additions to the LINAC that allows for a more accurate and optimal SRS treatments. One of them is use of non-coplanar beams. As the treatment paradigm shifts towards treating even multiple brain metastases with SRS instead of whole brain, these non-coplanar beam uses becomes more useful in SRS. So the older LINAC SRS, you would only be able to use the coplanar beams. So the coplanar beams are these here in this position. And a typical or one example of just using a coplanar beam SRS plan would be here on the right. And then when you include these other non-coplanar beams, the plan can be improved to appear like this. And this is the same patient. So if you just look at one lesion or one target on the two different plans, even with just one single target, by adding these non-coplanar beams, you get a lot less low dose to the normal brain that's nearby. But if you have multiple targets and they are in close proximity, if you're only limited to just using these coplanar beams, you're going to get a lot of this bridging in between. And certainly there's still low dose, but still you're getting these low dose to the normal brain. So in this plan though, by adding these non-coplanar beams to your plan, even though these two targets are in close proximity, you can still treat both at the same time and not have that bridging or low dose to the normal brain. So if you look at this here with it's a LINAC using coplanar as well as non-coplanar beams, it starts to look more like the Gamma Knife, but with no frame, with the ability to fractionate, have faster treatment times, and to have the versatility to also treat non-SRS treatments on the same machine. So we saw on that last slide that adding non-coplanar beams can be useful in getting better normal brain tissue sparing for SRS. For SRS, IGRT or image verification or image guidance on the LINAC is often done with cone beam CT. This cone beam CT can only be done at the coplanar beam position or the 0 degree. And it cannot be done at the non-coplanar position. So it is assumed that if this is in position or you're on target when the couches in the coplanar position and you move it to the non-coplanar configuration, that it would remain in the same position since you're using the same isocenter. There is no way to verify that if you don't have some other method. So prior to the SGRT or prior to the surface guided radiation therapy, they had X-ray images on the sort of side of the machines use the X-ray images to position the patients when they're in the non-coplanar beam positions. But this does use additional radiation and it also increases your treatment time. So instead, SGRT or surface guided radiation treatment can track the surface of the patient's face in all the beam positions throughout the entire course of the treatment. And it has automated beam shutoff if a patient moves outside of the predefined threshold. So SGRT or surface guided radiation therapy will continue to play an important role when non-coplanar beams are used. So when you start adding these multiple targets, multiple beams, angles, the treatment times start to increase. And so one way to reduce this is to use FFF beams or flattening filter-free beams. So the way that the LINAC works is the photon beams are generated by bombarding a high Z target with a high energy electron beam. It results in a beam that's almost like a bell shape and with the highest intensity at the center. So with 3D conformal treatments in the past, in order to get more of a uniform intensity across that one field or few field that you're using, you would place a flattening filter on the beam. But with IMRT and for smaller fields such as SRS, this renders this unnecessary. So as a treatment paradigm starts to favor SRS, even for these multiple brain metastases, you want more accuracy, but also faster treatment time. So the use of FFF can increase dose rates and especially useful with SRS as the doses are much higher. FFF can increase the dose rate by a factor of 2 to 4. And you're also gonna get lower peripheral dose due to decrease of photon head scatter, head leakage, and leaf transmission. For additional optimization of the treatment planning, as well as shortening the treatment time is the HyperArc. It's an addition that will optimize the treatment planning portion of the SRS. So it will, AI algorithm can select isodose, it can select ARCs for you. It will definitely have better algorithm for coming up with better treatment plans, especially for SRS. And the one really good thing on this is that you can do virtual dry runs. So although you can see the art or the angles and the arcs on the treatment plans for the non-coplanar planes, you aren't able to get an exact remake or a model of the treatment machine with that treatment. So without doing the actual treatment on the day of the treatment, you won't know whether there might be any collisions with the machine or the couch itself or the patient themselves. But this software will allow you to do those virtual dry runs. It is also a one-click treatment delivery. So currently, or without the HyperArc, if you're using non-coplanar beams, you would have to physically, or the therapist would have to come in to the machine and physically move the patient in that position before the other beams can be done or the treatments can be done. Whereas with the HyperArc, it's one click and all those are all automated and there's no manual intervention. So there are faster treatments to decrease the intrafraction motion possibility and more patients can be treated for that day. A again, since it's so important to radiation oncology to optimize this therapeutic window of higher tumor control and decreasing normal tissue damage, there have been several innovations throughout the years in radiation oncology that have significantly reduced the normal tissue dose. Currently, or the newest and latest that is will further reduce normal tissue dose is the ART. ART is adaptive radiation therapy. ART is a real-time adjustment. It's seen up here on the right corner here. It's a real-time adjustment of a radiation treatment plan to account for any tumor shrinkage or anatomy changes. So here, the figure is actually of a central SBRT for lung, where we're giving very high doses to a lung, lung cancer, and it's very close to the central structures. And while the plan, the initial plan looked very good when the patient came in for the actual treatment, the dose was not optimal for those normal structures. And so the ART would replant it in that time frame or a quick turnaround while the patient is still in position, and a new plan is developed and treated that day. So ART though cannot be possible without an MRI-Linac. The first versions of MRI-Linac was not a true MRI-Linac. It was more that they had an MRI on one side of the treatment room and then the Linac on the other side, and the couch would move to a certain position to get the MRI image and then to the treatment itself. We do now have several true MRI-Linacs. They are somewhat early phase of them. The first one that came out is the on the left here, the Meridium by ViewRay. It combines as a 0.35T MRI with a 6 MV linear accelerator. The one that's come out after that is the Electa Unity, which is on the right here. And this combines a 1.5T MRI with a 7 MV FFF Linac. Artificial intelligence is actually already an integral part of radiation treatment, from data collection, tumor identifications, targeting, to treatment planning and delivery, and then to image surveillance. The more that AI continues to be used, it learns and it gets smarter, it'll become more accurate and efficient. So I think the AI role is likely to grow a lot more in the future, especially in radiation oncology, but certainly in all of medicine. And I will end with a picture of our main campus in Duarte that is currently being expanded, as well as our South Bay City of Hope site here in Torrance. I would commend City of Hope as it has also committed to keeping the technology up to date, even at their community expansion sites. Thank you.
Thank you, G. That was wonderful. I learned a ton there. I believe we have a couple of questions. Why don't we start with the audience ones when Dr. Guan is...
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Kim. That was fantastic. So I think the first one is from Dr. Briganti. And, you know, I think this is sort of segging off of your access to care part of your presentation. Do you have any sort of sense of what hospitals in LA County have, sort of some of these, you know, newer technologies, have these sort of newest machines? You know, are there cases where, you know, one might be better suited for something than the other, and you have patients go, you know, from place to place?
Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, the, your more typical, I guess, SRS, again, it's hard to say because, you know, you do need the technology in place in terms of the machine, but you also definitely need the team or the radiation oncology team to be experienced in doing a lot of these SRS. But I can, you know, if you had to really pick why you would do Gamma Knife versus the other, you know, for Gamma Knife, you know, really, if it's very, very small targets, like for trigeminal neuralgia, I think Gamma Knife are the best for those. For everything else, I think you're on an even playing field between all the three. In terms of which centers have, you know, it's hard to say. I don't know what each center has, but I can tell you that all the LA academic centers have the latest technology and the knowledge and the experience to treat those, you know, much more advanced or much more with the newest sort of technology. The MRI Linux, you know, it is like the next emerging, although I can tell you that most centers don't have that yet, except for the academic centers. In brain though, or looking specifically at brain, I think the most useful, at least at this point, is going to be in the, if you're worried about the cavity shrinkage after post-op SRS, but you're going to get the MRI within 7 days. So re-imaging at the real time is, you know, you're not going to see much change with the brain, you know, so it makes sense for the lung, prostate, other, you know, sites. The other thing is the LINAC or the radiation treatment on the MRI LINACs are still pretty early. So they're only able to do step and shoot IMRT on those, at least for now. I'm sure newer machines will come out in the future where they're able to do these VMATs along with the MRI.
I guess in connection to that, you know, both Wally and I trained at a place that saw a decent amount of chordomas, and there were, you know, cases, at least for that, where, you know, there's a lot of discussion about proton and sending people to proton centers. And I know that's something that, you know, is not widely available. I mean, I guess if you have any thoughts on proton, like it's, I don't know, I've talked to some people who said that, you know, it's really useful. Some people say it's sort of marginal. Some people think it's sort of a gimmick. You know, do you have any thoughts on proton or what, you know, the benefits?
Yeah, so proton, like you said, chordoma is one of the, maybe the only, but it is one of the sites or the brain basal skull chordomas is the one site where it has been clinically proven that protons are far superior. So we absolutely refer patients to proton centers for that. For SRS or, you know, or protons, most of these patients or the use of protons are gonna be in your pediatric patients. And you would not be doing SRS for pediatric patients.
Have you worked with the other non-LINAC based systems?
I've worked with both, not the newest CyberKnife or GammaKnife, but I have worked with the CyberKnife as well as the older GammaKnife.
Is your preference also the LINAC? We've talked to a lot of radiation.
It is.
Yeah, right.
Just because of the, you know, that you can do a frameless type of treatment, it's faster. There's a lot more you can, now there's more tools that you can add to the LINAC. Whereas I think the CyberKnife is a little bit more limited in those additional tools.
Mm-hmm. For the audience that doesn't know, that frame, especially for these cancer patients, it creates a feeling of claustrophobia a lot of times. And it's just, it's a very uncomfortable experience, or at least that's what they tell me quite frequently. So we've been a lot happier using the frameless systems.
Yeah.
One more question from the audience here as well. Talking about trigeminal neuralgia, I guess, are there certain characteristics of patients that you select for, you know, Gamma Knife treatment of trigeminal neuralgia versus other, you know, management strategies?
The reason for, I think that trigeminal neuralgia is best suited for Gamma Knife is just the target is so small. So when you get these very, very small targets, I think that is the most ideal to be treated by. Everything beyond that size, very, very tiny targets, it's a even playing field, I feel.
So I do a lot of the referrals of the trigeminal neuralgia patients for either of these. For the audience again, the typical practices are either balloon or glycerol to the nerve, microvascular open surgical decompression of the trigeminal nerve, or radiation to the nerve itself. And it's typically reserved for patients who are absolutely anti-surgery or who are not medically well enough to undergo a surgical procedure requiring general anesthesia. It tends to be well tolerated, but in general, the recurrence rates tend to be a little bit higher as well in trigeminal neuralgia. Yeah, Dr. Wollman's mentioning this here, yeah. So Dr. Wollman is mentioning at St. John's, we do frameless SRS that with cones on the edge LINAC for trigeminal neuralgia, so no need for gamma knife. And that's proven to be very effective as well. Currently, G, if I'm not mistaken, we don't have that set up at the South Bay yet. Is that correct?
No. Yeah, but we do have the surface guidance now, and then we will be getting the it's in the works of getting that hyper arc.
Great, great. Wonderful. I don't believe there are any other questions. Gee, that was really, really great. So thank you very much. I know everybody learned a ton from that. What we're going to do, we're going to go ahead and sign off. Next month will be a lecture on neuro-ophthalmology by Dr. Kimberly Cockerham. You're not going to want to miss that. If there's any questions or suggestions or hopes for future talks, please let us know. You can go ahead and put it in the comment box or question or email any of us. And we look forward to seeing you all next month. Everybody have a happy and safe rest of July. Thanks again, G.
Thank you for having me.
Of course.